two songs playing. Good morning. How is everyone? Hey, Jamie's here. Hi. It's good to see you. Comes Natalie with her multicolored scarf. That's beautiful. Hey, I have a couple of announcements for you. Debbie and I got a real treat this week. We got to see Craig and Phyllis. They are doing well. They were really... They just look fantastic, and they're celebrating March 11th, so yesterday, they celebrated 67 years of marriage. You know, yes, Craig and Phyllis, if you're watching, happy anniversary. You know, I would like to be married to Annette for 67 years. I don't know that she could handle 67 years. I'm surprised that she made it 67 days, but a couple other announcements. Welcome to Kathy Connor, who joined us this past week, but I see that she's not here today. But welcome, Kathy, if you're watching online. Thanks to everyone for their Easter flower order. If you've not made your order yet and you want to, you've got till March 15th. So that's coming up in 3 days. Get with Debbie or Bonnie and order your flowers. Bible reading plans are still on the sharing table, and it's not too late to join us on that. You can catch up in no time, but it'll get you through the New Testament and all of Psalms and Proverbs in 18 months. And it's a real easy way to try to read through the Bible. So I encourage you to do that. If you've already started it or you started it and then stopped, get back in it. It's not that difficult. We'll get through this together. And we learn a lot because we're taking small chunks of the Bible in reading. So I would encourage you to join us for that. The good news is also that the chapel is almost done. There are a few other things that we've got to do up there. But anyway, we're ready. We're going to have a sunrise service Easter morning. It'll be 7:30 in the morning on Easter Sunday. We'll christen that. And then after that, we'll have our Wednesday morning Bible study in there as well. Cliff, thanks for your work upstairs. He's been doing some work in the education room. The TV is mounted up there that we got. And Debbie has, you cannot take the teacher out of her. She's got a series of books, the books of Narnia, C.S. Lewis books. They're out there on the table in the narthex if you'd like to read them. And to get you started, if you want to get an idea what it's about, Debbie read it, and she even wrote a book report on it. So you can read Debbie's book report to figure out if it's something you want to do. Any other announcements? Jeff, Debbie, Cliff? Trustee meeting this Tuesday, 6:30? 6 p.m. Okay, I invite you to stand for our call to worship coming to us from Psalm 4. Answer me when I call to you, O my righteous God. Give me relief from my distress. Be merciful to me and hear my prayer. How long, O men, will you turn glory to shame, love delusions, and seek false gods? No, the Lord has set apart the godly for himself. The Lord will hear when I call to him. In anger, do not sin. In the night, search your hearts and be silent. Offer right sacrifice and trust in God. You, O Lord, fill us with joy. Give us restful sleep, and we dwell safely in you. Amen. Our opening hymn has been changed, not by me. Just want to get that out there. But Lexi chose a new hymn, and she made sure to write it in my bulletin so I could get it right. It's Be Still My Soul. Let's sing our praises to God this morning. What praises or prayer concerns are on your heart this morning that you'd like to present?
Ruth.
Ann passed away last night.
Oh.
Oh.
Okay. This is one of those happy, sad occasions. Him was a dear friend to a lot of us. But today, this morning, she woke up in the face of God in perfect health. Amen. Mike?
I would just like to invite everybody to come up and have the pastor come down and pray for him because he has surgery.
Kind of late to be asking me now. It's okay.
Don't heal.
Yeah.
I was worried because you had a determined look on your face when you came up, and I thought I was in trouble.
I thought about this the last few days. I thought, you know what? What I'm going to ask you to do is, anybody who has a prayer request, maybe didn't get a chance to say that or pray, go ahead and do that, and then I'll end up with the prayer.
Any other prayer requests?
Bob, I just do Greg and I are vaccinated bothers.
Okay. Okay.
My friend Andy, who was on, left the hospital Friday to go to a restaurant with his son, and as he opened the door, his femur broke.
Oh my gosh.
He, instead of taking the grant and took him back to James, he'd been battling cancer, disease terminal, and they didn't think he was going to make it over the weekend because his kidneys are shot, but they got him through the weekend. He's now in rehab, but still struggling. So those of you who are praying for Andy on the list, thank you for doing that. So.
We'll keep praying for Andy. Mary?
My cousin Nancy, she's been through trying two treatments for her cancer. Neither worked, but they're hopeful for a third.
Okay.
She's saying she can come back this week.
Okay, we'll keep praying there. That was fun. We did this. But for those who weren't able, for those of you who weren't there, Bob is wearing his Friday necktie on Sunday morning.
He's had a long weekend.
We're not going there. Okay, it'll be all right. Yeah.
She had a cookie too.
Okay.
Anybody that missed not there?
He missed.
And Angela and Cliff weren't there, but they're here now.
Yeah.
Good to see Angela. All right, Mike.
My friend passed away just a few weeks ago at my age from cancer. His wife is paralyzed, been paralyzed since in the 70s, and she missed cancer. She's going through. Heavenly Father, we just want to bring our prayer requests and our praises to you. We thank you for everything you've done for us, how you're with us every moment of the day. We just ask you to meet the needs that we have, that we've shared with you, or that have been some unspoken ones, Lord, that you know of. And that's the nice part about it. You know it before we do. We just ask you to be with us. Be with the doctors, and nurses, and medical staff, friends and family, and the pastor, because he has a surgery tomorrow. Be with them now. Help them to get a good night's sleep tonight. Help them to be ready for this tomorrow. Hopefully, smoothly, and he will not have any problems. Be with them, Lord, every step of the way. We ask you to give the service today, Lord. Give us a kind of mercy.
Amen. Thank you so much, everybody.
Go back to your seats, go.
So for those of you who haven't been here or missed, I'm having knee replacement surgery tomorrow morning, and I won't be here next Sunday in person. But the message has been recorded. Mr. Cliff will be running that, and we're going to record a special children's time today after service for that. So that'll be worth you showing up to be able to see that next week. I'm a bit iffy on the 26th. I think we're going to go ahead and record it or do something this week. So that'll be here for you. I think I'll be here. But I don't know that I'll be preaching live. It may be recorded. So we'll just see how that goes. But thank you for your prayers. Now I invite you to stand for our doxology.
Amen.
We thank you so much for the gifts you've given us. Lord, we ask that you would receive our gifts as a token of our love and appreciation. We ask that you bless them and anoint them for your purpose. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. So if you ever had to do something and you didn't know how you were going to do it or what you were going to do, something like that, I'm all tangled up here. Well, that's the way this morning was. I didn't know what I was going to do for children's time, and I was trying to think about it. Thanks to Mike, I now have my theme for children's time. And all of you, do you know what the one of the nicest things that we could do for another person is? Mm-hmm. What can we do? What?
Be nice.
We can be nice to them. That'd really be good. So how can we be nice to them? How can we be nice to other people? We could share things with them. That'd be good. So if you're, how old are you now again?
Eight.
Eight? So if I were an eight-year-old, I think one of the things that we could do is maybe go on the swings together, maybe go to the park. In the summer, we could ride our bikes together, go to the swimming pool. If you had a girlfriend about 8 or 9 years old, do you do sleepovers? You do stuff like that? Have your friends stay with you all night and go to their house? We could do, what else could we do together? I know one thing that we could do together that you haven't thought of. Could we pray for them? I think that is one of the most intimate things that we could ever do for anyone, is to pray for them. So many times, and maybe you've done this, where somebody says, they ask you, if you think about it, can you pray for me? I'm doing this, or I'm having a test tomorrow, or I'm not feeling well. Would you pray for me? And a lot of times, my answer is yes. And then, if I don't do it right away, sometimes I forget. And I don't want to do that. I don't want to forget, especially my church family, because you're very important to me. But I've learned that if I don't pray in that moment, there are times when I do forget, or I don't know, I'm just not as good about it. So I need to pray in the moment. And then the other thing is, when I do that, when I pray in that moment, it also helps me remember later, because it's kind of cemented itself in my mind. So what everyone did this morning for me for my surgery tomorrow was really, really special. That meant a lot to me, and it lets people know that you think of them. So I think one of the things that I want to do right now, because we're friends, right? Aren't we friends? You do that thing where you fall backwards and I catch you, right? Because you trust me, right? One of the things that I think I can do for you right now to show you that I love you and you're my friend, I'm going to pray for you, okay? Just like everybody came up and prayed for me, I'm going to do that right now for you. And I'm going to do this for any of our youth that are here this morning, any the youth that are watching online. But I'm going to also pray for you specifically, okay? Dear Lord, I ask that you'd be with Jamie and you'd be with all of our youth, children, whether they're here or not, whether they're watching online, or they may watch, they may see this service a week from now or a month from now. Lord, I just pray that any youth that are blessed by this service, by this message, including Jamie, who's here right now, Lord, I pray that you would keep those children safe, that you would help them have lots of friends, good close friends, some that are just friends for a day or two, but other friends who are lifelong, lasting companions, that years from now they may run into each other and they can just pick up right where they left off. Lord, I pray that you'd help them in their schoolwork, that you'd give them a calling and a purpose and a mission in life that inspires them all their days, that they would find that sweet spot of serving you with the passion of something that they really, really enjoy, and that they can possibly make a career or an avocation from that. Lord, I pray that they would have parents and aunts and uncles and grandparents who would love on them and dote on them and not just give them what they want, but give them what they need. And one of the things they need is good role models. Lord, I pray that generosity would be bestowed on them, that they would experience the storehouse of heaven that you have for them, that they would know all their life that whether things are going good or whether things are going badly, there is a God in heaven that loves them. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, my good friend.
Today's scripture from Luke 21, 1 through 11. As he looked up, Jesus saw the rich putting their gifts into the temple treasury. He also saw a poor widow put in two very small copper coins. I tell you the truth, he said, this poor widow has put in more than all the others. All these people gave their gifts out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in all she had to live on. Some of his disciples were remarking about how the temple was adorned with beautiful stones and with gifts dedicated to God. But Jesus said, as for what you see here, the time will come when not one stone will be left on another. Every one of them will be thrown down. Teacher, they asked, when will these things happen? And what will be the sign that they are about to take place? He replied, watch out that you are not deceived, for many will come in my name, claiming, I am he, and the time is near. Do not follow them. When you hear of wars and revolutions, do not be frightened. These things must happen first, but the end will not come right away. Then he said to them, nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, famine, and pestilences in various places, and fearful events, and great signs from heaven. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Let's sing, Lord, I Lift Your Name on High. She's walked out. Is this in your bulletin? I want to encourage you to consider this. LookUp Center is looking for help, someone that can delegate, lead, and has a heart for serving others, to do about 10 to 15 hours worth of work a week for their opportunity store. I really do endorse this organization and what they're doing in Newark. So I'd encourage you to consider that if that's something that you think might be interesting for you to get involved in. I'm still mourning. I'm going to dedicate the message to Ann, who passed away. Let's pray. Dear God, accept us as we are. Just as you accepted Ann, Lord, we ask that you accept us. Lord, love us with your whole being, but call us to a deeper faith and a commitment to you. Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts would be pleasing to you. Amen. My name doesn't matter. I was just a poor widow that day in the temple. I might be old, but not much gets past me. The Pharisees were anything but holy. I watched this new rabbi, Jesus. My, I'd never seen such kind eyes, so filled with love. It wasn't until after his resurrection that I learned what he'd said about me. One of his disciples told me how he commented about my meager offering, and boy, I imagine the Pharisees didn't like that. I've always given what I had. And Yahweh has always provided just as he promised. I'm surprised Jesus made such a big deal out of my offering. If I didn't believe that God would provide for my needs, it wouldn't be much of a faith, would it? To learn that my Lord singled out my offering and then took my offering to the cross, my unworthiness, it's more than I can comprehend. I want us to tease apart this scripture this morning. The biggest lesson, though, that I got from it is rather small. It's about 73 words, roughly 45 seconds worth of reading. First point, we're going to look at quality over quantity. God wants our best, not our 10% tithe. Second, God has made a way where there was no way. The way is Jesus Christ. God's provision is a promise to meet all our needs according to his riches in glory. And third, things of the earth will not stand. But what God has enacted, what he establishes, will stand for all time. This message today is about first fruits. It's about giving what is dear to us to another. We take what we have, we give to another. Jeremy was going to be 8 years old, so he's Natalie's age. Or, not Natalie's age, he's Jamie's age. Sorry, Natalie. You'll take that as a compliment, okay. Jeremy was going to be 8, and his dad asked him what he wanted for his birthday, and he said, I want a ball. And his dad asked him, what do you want, a football, a baseball, a basketball? He said, I want any ball that you will throw with me. First fruits are our crops, our earnings, our talents, and our time. So I want us to look at the quality of our giving and our doing. God's way to salvation and his eternal words of provision. When we read Hebrews chapters 4 and 5, they are some of the best scriptures that are key to helping us understand the widow's mite story. The writer expressed it this way. We have a high priest who can empathize with our weakness, who was tempted in every way as we are, yet he did not sin. Every high priest is selected from the people and appointed to present matters to God. That's how the high priest is chosen. That's the high priest's function. Jesus is our high priest. He was born to die for us, but also to experience life. He came from the people. He was 100% God, but 100% human. He isn't just compassionate, he's empathetic. There's a difference. He understands what it's like to be tempted, to suffer, to have illness. So this morning, let's become the widow. Let's empathize with her. Let's step into her situation. As we go to synagogue, we're going to put our offering in. We're going to open up that small leather purse that we carry, and we're going to draw out 2 copper coins. 2 small copper coins, the least value of any coin at that time. And Jesus said, this poor widow put in all she had to live on. When I read that story, I get the sense that this widow has no one else alive to take care of her, no one to give her support. Because if there was anyone helping, Jesus would not have said she put in all she had. She obviously didn't have any help. Our tithing is not the meaning of this message this morning. This message is about trusting God for our provision, and it's prioritizing the things that are eternal. It's about giving our best. It's not about quantity. It is about quality. The Bible refers to our best as giving our first fruits. The value depends on whose hands are holding it. This basketball is worth about $20 or $30. You could probably get them for less. This paintbrush, maybe 50 cents. I don't know what a good paintbrush costs. In 2 cents, well, it's not hard to figure out. It's 2 cents. That's what it's worth. But in the right hands, LeBron James holds a basketball. It's worth millions of dollars. Paintbrush by Rembrandt, millions of dollars. A widow holding 2 copper pennies, it's worth a fortune. It's eternal. And Jesus Christ said so. That's how God's sliding scale works. It doesn't work the way we think things ought to work. Nails driven into my hands. They cause me intense pain. But Jesus Christ's hands, invaluable. How do you put a price on eternal salvation? Jesus gave his best. How can we give any less? A little over 2,000 years ago, we were stuck in our sin. We had no recourse, no way of getting out of our sin. We could sacrifice doves and bulls and sheep and goats. We're still trapped. That widow, I'm sure she was a wonderful old lady. I'm sure she was the nicest. I'm sure that for whatever time she was married, she was a wonderful wife. But as good as she was, her goodness was meaningless because she had no road away from judgment. Just as God provided for her sustenance, though, her daily food and her health and all those things, he made a way for her to receive grace. And he makes a way for us to receive grace. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes on him should not perish but have eternal life. Because God did not come into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world. Copper is mined from the earth. It's rock. It's stone. It has no value except the value that we place upon it. The widow got it. You see, she heard Jesus' words, the words of the prophets, the words of the patriarchs. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean on not on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight. See, she got that there was a way for her. She trusted in God. Her true provision came from the storehouse of heaven, not from those pennies that she held. God was making a way. She had faith and trust in God that he would fulfill his promises. She had no reservation about putting her last two coins in the collection. Sometimes I believe that we take the way, we take Christ for granted. We're saved without limit, and we forget the cost to God, his only Son, his one and only Son, excruciating physical pain, incredible mental abuse, and devastating spiritual separation from God the Father and God the Holy Spirit. The cost to us is free. But to Jesus, it cost everything. And that is something that I think the stones will cry out about. That makes copper pennies more valuable than gold. Earthly souls are made more valuable than God's own life. God sacrificed Jesus Christ for us, all of us. There wasn't a way, but there is now. So remember this, God wants our best. He wants our first fruits. He wants our all. Jesus gave his all for us, and I don't think we should give less. The important point for us to remember is that we don't love Jesus just an hour on Sunday morning. We just don't come here and yeah, we worship you, we praise you, we love you, Lord. Okay, let's go to Roadhouse or wherever it is. So let's not go to Kroger. And no, it's not about getting on with our day. It's about loving God and taking God with us through our day. What God has enacted, what he has accomplished, is eternal. In Matthew's Gospel, chapter 24, verse 35, Jesus said, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away." Well, Jesus said he would provide for us. That's for all time. He will always meet our needs, not just for today. I want you to listen to these letters. This was a book that I rescued from the library. "Dear God, count me in. Your friend, Herbie." Don't you want to be like Herbie? Listen to this letter from Lewis. Dear God, I wrote you before. Do you remember? Well, I did what I promised, but you did not send me the horse yet. What about it? Growing up, I was more like Lewis and a lot less like Herbie. As I've grown up, it's more of a struggle. I want to be more like Herbie, but I find myself once in a while I'm a little more like Lewis. Giving our best, our first fruits, tells God that we're all in. Are we all in? What about it? What about it? Are we? It tells God that we're not worried about our comfort zone. You can count on me. Count me in, God. The widow was all in. She put everything she had in the collection. She trusted God for her sustenance. She didn't run out and buy a saddle. What God has established, his promises, eternal salvation and sustenance for his children, are forever promises. They're on rock solid foundation. You can be trusted that he'll follow through on those promises. Our first fruits are those things that we do utilizing what God has given us. And sometimes those first fruits are things that make us uncomfortable. Those things that cause us to grow in faith because we're totally dependent on God. I'm going to skip down a little bit here, Robert. Not doing what I've been called to do would be sinful. Puts more stones in the wheelbarrow. What is it that you need to offer God today? If you don't praise God with your first fruits, I believe the stones will cry out and leave you waiting for a horse like Lewis. You see, it's a calling, but it's a choice. God gives us a calling. He gives us a passion on our hearts. And we know it because we get that sense of obligation. It's an urge. I need to do this. I want to do it. And then comes the comma and the but after it. And that's where we don't give our first fruits, because it takes us out of our comfort zone. Praise God or don't. Praise God or don't praise him. But there's no almost. There's no God, I'm going to join you partially. Need to be like Herbie. I'm all in, God. What we do for Christ is glorified in heaven for eternity or not. For some of us, maybe God just wants us to play ball with him. Spend a few minutes in prayer. Maybe a devotion once a day. Grateful acknowledgement of what we've been given. A little bit of time reading the Bible. Maybe that's it. Maybe that's what God wants, our time. A lot of times we can be more generous with our pocketbook, our wallet. We hoard our time. What would it be like if we didn't have God on a timesheet? Maybe we do need to follow the example of the widow. Maybe we do need to open that leather coin purse and let the moths out. Maybe we need to fix someone a meal and take it to them and say, you know, I was thinking of you, and Or maybe we need to have a meal with someone. It must be rough sometimes having dinner by yourself. I thought I'd just bring dinner over and join you if that's okay. Maybe a note card, the old-fashioned way, you know, the one where you put the stamp on it. And maybe it'll get there too. What if we served on a mission team? Doesn't have to be a long one. Doesn't have to be to Haiti or Africa. What about southern Kentucky? What about right here in Newark? Something that takes us out of our comfort zone. And maybe we could be an encourager for another. I don't know about you, but there are a lot of times when I just need a word of encouragement. That just gives me that much more energy. All we have and all we are is God's gift to us. What we do with what He's given us is our gift back to Him. One of the things we do at weddings is we pray. The pastor says, what God has joined together, let no man tear apart. What God has joined together is eternal. That's the way our lives are supposed to be. When we make our promise, when we make our commitment to God, that's eternal. But do we really mean it? By Jesus' statement, two small copper coins outlast the stones in the temple. And that was fulfilled. What that widow did that day is still told around the world. That endures in heaven today. That temple was destroyed in 70 AD. And that's my message this morning. Amen. I'd invite us to stand and sing our hymn, You Are My King. Think about these words as we sing to God. Officially now part of the team. The song mess up a while ago just puts you right up here with Pastor,
yeah.
And you are totally in with us now. And that just extends your contract with us inevitably.
Right.
So you are in.
Thank you.
Lexi, I love you singing and playing for us.
Thank you.
don't let stuff bother you. Not that you were, but it's all good. Don't you think she does a good job? Years ago, a man made some of the finest violins, and he threw away almost more violins than he made because he didn't like how they were turning out. And he said, no one will ever make a better violin because God's music needs to come from the best violin, and his name was Stradivarius. That's the best. God wants our best. Not our most, and his name is Jesus. God made a way where there was no way. His name is Jesus. And what God establishes on earth will be established for all time, because his words will never pass away. His name is Jesus. Amen.